The main thing is the presence. The main thing is the presence. All right? This is the truth. Ram Maharshi said in response to a question, how do you find it? What kind of guru should you really look for? And he said, look for the one in whose presence you feel peace. In whose presence you feel peace. He's not talking about the words. He's talking about presence. And presence is 360 degree, is it not? This is what we mean by presence. It's 360 degree. Okay. It's not some line of thinking or a structure of a concept here or there. It's 360 degrees. So the Holy Spirit is really pushing me, and I have to admit, I don't understand it. I really don't. The skateboard thing, it's pushing, Holy Spirit's pushing this. It's just like, wow, what in the world is going on? I do not know. That's okay. I did skate today for the second time, and this time I went down kind of a narrow sort of a trail, and had to turn a lot to slow down. I tightened my wheels. It was great. When I went going downhill, I tightened them up really tight, so it slowed me down. Then going uphill, pushing uphill, I loosened them up, and that worked great. So so this is more skating than I did the first time, quite a bit more, and had to do some really fast, tight turns, and I was able to do it. Didn't have any problems. Then I ran stairs and still working out like this. So what? I don't understand it. Okay, so it. But I trust it. I trust it. There's something about the flow, the presence, the awareness, the unfixatedness. The Holy Spirit is getting at it from the physical standpoint, telling me that mentally I'm there, but the physical standpoint in here, as we think of ourselves as a physical presence, that we have to something has to really, it has to be a presence. It cannot just be a blah 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 teacher like that. It's a presence. Still have this little flicker thing going on, but it gives us nice little light show every now and then. So a very intense workout today. The skating was pretty amazing. It was pretty amazing in that I was able to do it, and the board worked very well. And just cruising, you know, I don't do tricks at this point. I find those too difficult, to say the least. And I'm just barely getting my feet wet. And then the Holy Spirit's giving me more pressure to do more. It's like, wow, are you kidding me? I said, no, it'll be okay. It'll be, don't worry, you'll be fine. I said, oh my gosh. So you may be getting more in some way. You sooner or later, perhaps something will. You know, a video will pop up. Now, so people were used to, you know, listening to the teacher say, yes, it's this, it's that, you don't need to understand it, this, that. But the Holy Spirit is beyond teachers and teaching and all of this. The Holy Spirit's the ultimate teacher, actually. And it views your life in a 360 degree way. All right. It doesn't just look at your spiritual studies, say, okay, you're studying this book, that's great, maybe you should pay more attention to this quote or something. That's not the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit sees everything, complete 360 degreeness from now to eternity, and it's already saved you. It already knows everything about your salvation. And so it's involved in a 360 degree way. This is what I'm noticing. The way it gets my attention is so extraordinary. People will call me out of the blue with some stupid question or something, and it'll point me to the next step I need to take. I said, what in the world? What a crazy call. But then I suddenly say, oh my gosh, he's pushing me in this direction. I see that. I see it very much so. I said, Wow. So the Holy Spirit will use anything and everything. It doesn't have to be some quote unquote spiritual person that helps you out. In fact, everybody I meet helps me out. It's like everything I do, everyone I meet, everything is like helping me out with the answers. Really, seriously. Anybody you know. The Holy Spirit speaks to them, puts words into their mouth. It's just the orchestration of our salvation. The Holy Spirit is orchestrating everyone's salvation simultaneously. Okay, there is no linearness to the Holy Spirit in that way. It's all everyone's salvation. It's orchestrating us all together. This. Every, it's beyond our comprehension, actually, how this could possibly take place, but it does. A lot of people my generation are have cut the news out. This is what I come across people. I say, oh, I don't listen to radio news or I don't paper anymore. No more news. I say, wow, really? Me too. We're waking up. We're getting smart, actually. My generation is a very, very wise generation, actually. We grew up in a time that it's showing that right now that we're having the wisdom to say, hey, enough is enough. Enough is enough. Of this nonsense, this absolute nonsense. This world is, again, there's a purpose. There is a purpose behind this world, and the purpose is to change what we are. And the world is a tool that we're using to try to change what we are. That's very simply put and very accurate. I know the Gnostics talked about the demiurge and this and that, the world is a negative, diabolical thing. Well, they were essentially right. They had some, dualistic. They didn't quite know how to get liberated, but they were, in the ballpark in terms of talking about this world. It truly, but they didn't know who they didn't know. They invented someone that made, they say, this someone made this world. Well, no, we are projecting this world every moment. It's our own mind that is doing this. There's nobody doing this to us at all. So they were mistaken about that, but they're right about this world is very malevolent in terms of its design and purpose is despair. It truly is. Now, you might be listening to this and say, oh, how awful this to find out the world is nothing, its purpose just despair. That's so despairing. Okay, so this is the trouble, isn't it? Now, the reason why I've been able to get through so it's not a problem at all for me to say this. In fact, it's wonderful to hear this. Oh, finally I understand the world. I understand it's all coming very clear. Is because of Jesus Christ. What did Jesus do that was so helpful in his attitude of love to us as he explained everything, the way he did it was he said, look, I know this is very difficult for you, but I say this with so much love for all of you, and I want you to hear this, that it's coming from my great love for you. And he continuously reassures us and says, yes, I very clearly understand how difficult this is for you. And yet there will come a moment eventually where it will not be so difficult for you. And I promise you this. So Jesus is profoundly reassuring. He's such a we can't, I don't even put a label on it as far as such a teacher. There's no label we can put on it, actually. Wisdom and compassion, you might say, both there in perfect, perfect harmony. It just the wisdom and the compassion to tell us flat out the truth. This is what I was waiting for. This is the teaching I was waiting for in this world, is who can tell us the actual truth about everything and do it in a way that doesn't is not off-putting for us. And Jesus Christ delivered the goods. He delivered the goods. That is a fact, plain and simple fact. So I saw that and I said, wow, this is what I've always wanted. This is what I'm ready for. And it's you got to go slowly. It does hurt. It is difficult for us. He was absolutely right. When he says it's very, very difficult, he's absolutely right. But it was the love he has for us that pulls us through. And we realize he is telling us this, even though he knows this scares us. He's doing it because he knows it's for our own good. It's like a great, parent or something, older brother, so to speak, that says, "Look, I know this is tough for you, but you got to come out here and skate, something like that. You got to get out there on your skateboard and skate. I know it's not easy for you, but you got to do it. And you might have, well, hopefully you don't have any tumbles." I'm not aiming for any tumbles, actually. So you go at it, and very few have gotten this far because it is so difficult, and you have to keep working at it every day, religiously, every day, every day, every day, every day. Just get used to it over and over and over. Get used to it because it is indeed extremely difficult. So I pass this on with great love to everyone, knowing how difficult it is, and yet it's the right thing to do to speak the truth here. And many pick up on it, and many don't. Yet they will eventually. So Jesus really, really has told us the truth about the whole situation. He doesn't hold anything back. Now, we got a very strong dose of that from Ram Maharshi. He's been extremely helpful, because also he doesn't hold anything back. And Sargadatta Maharaj, and these Dharma kings, they don't hold anything back. That is what I love so much about them, is they tell us the truth about it, even though they know we don't like to hear this. So there's just this host of defensiveness that we have, that we just say, "Ah, I don't want to hear this." As if to find out the purpose of this world is despair is somehow despairing. But say, wait a minute. If the purpose of this world is despair, and is there a way to get free of it? That's the first question I would ask, right? Well, we don't just when we hear this, we'd say, "Okay, well, how do I get free of it?" And then the Holy Spirit starts to focus us on that. So I didn't despair so much when I heard this. I just said, "Okay, yeah, I think you're right, Jesus. I believe, I really feel strongly that you're right about this. I really felt very strongly from the very start that what Jesus was saying is absolutely true." So I didn't have, like, but even then, it's like, yeah, but it's kind of like, I feel scared. I can't really understand. It's just there's some resistances and but I did really, really believe what he had to say, and feel that this is truly correct teaching. In Journey Beyond Words and A Course in Miracles, and the other voice, and what he had to, what he has to say. I say, yeah, that's it. That is true. That is very true. And I say, but then I tell him, Jesus, I said, there's not many that will accept this as true. But he said it anyway. This is another thing I love about Jesus, is that he doesn't care about his popularity. He really doesn't. If he wanted to be a popular teacher, he would have given a different teaching out, and the whole world would have bowed to him and said, "Oh, what a great teacher." I mean, every Dharma king has gone through this temptation where the world says, "Look, let's set you up as the world teacher, but you just got to alter things a little bit. You can't go around saying the purpose of the world is despair, and it's trying to change what we are, and it's just a dream that we're projecting, and it really has no value at all. You can't say that. I mean, people won't follow you if you say that. So if you just change this central, the key message, just change it. Then everybody will follow you, and then you can love everybody with compassion, everybody, and the world will be saved." This is what the ego tells us. But Jesus doesn't do that, does he? No, he doesn't do that at all. He says, "This is the truth. I have to tell you this with so much love. I know it's going to hurt you. You're going to be upset with me, maybe. You're going to find it very difficult. But the Holy Spirit has already saved you, and so you will make it through. There's no question about it. He has absolute faith in us, absolute faith in us. But he's not running a popularity contest. So what he has to say certainly is not acceptable to most in the world. And some of it's acceptable, but then there's other parts that that many will say, oh, that's just too much. That's just not acceptable. Can't we just cherry pick, what he said and just get the parts we like and then fashion a religion around it? Hey, well, I said, hey, that's already been done. It's already been done. We already been there, done that. Let's not do that again, right? All this cherry picking that we do have done already. It's time for that to realize that's a failure. You can't pick and choose what parts of truth you like. And this is what he told us as well. So what am I doing going out skateboarding? I don't know. I watched some more skateboarding videos. The search for Mr. Chin. The Bones Brigade search for Mr. Chin. I watched about half of it. Pretty amazing stuff. Skating through the streets of San Francisco, that was pretty awesome to watch, actually. Skating in this storm drain in Hawaii, then going to Bakersfield ramp in Bakersfield, but going through San Francisco is like, wow. And the I'm just watching this. I'm just saying, wow. It's very wowish, actually, which is why I like it. It really is very wowish. These young men were so creative and innovative and daring and just spirited, and they said, we see a different use for this city. That there's no obstacles for us in this city. We can skate over and around and above and through these obstacles and just flow here and flow there, and going down these hills and jumping over the, it's just spectacular how they a whole group of them doing this. They're all so good. They're all so talented. Young guys. One of the stars of the movie, who's one of the voted like the best skateboarder of the century. My buddy skated with him a lot, was part of his team actually. And he's the one that kind of has sort of helped nudge me into skateboarding. So he was like skating with the skateboarder of the century. It's pretty cool. And so you see in the pictures of him when he was young, and you can see why these guys are so good. They're ridiculously good. They're just super super almost like gymnasts in their balance and their quick reflexes and every like it's just don't go skating down the streets of San Francisco like they were doing. Of course, all the traffic was cleared and just the but filming it was it's just really 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 cool to see that. I like that better than the pools and the vert stuff. It gets pretty boring. To tell you the truth, the vert stuff gets boring. Just over and over again, aerial, aerial, lip, aerial. Okay. But skating through the streets of San Francisco, I mean, they're just blending into everything. I mean, they're just there's everything. It's just the streets, jumping over the curbs and brick wall here, and flying over this and that, and just that. That is really cool. It's not some artificial ramp or pool where they just kind of go round and round the pool and the aerial this aerial that. No, I like street skating better. I like Lance Mountain. He was the guy that starred in the Bones Brigade, the first video, just the Bones Brigade. It was beautiful the way he skated through a city, just beautiful, so creative and with good humor, and wow, it's like a different kind of dance. It's like you're just sort of floating through the cityscape, and have different ideas for what is this? Oh, this is something to leap up onto and slide along, and then leap back off of it, and it's what? Instead of just tromping along, everybody's just tromping along in this world, aren't we? Just clomp, 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 clomp. Now, I had a very, very interesting experience today running stairs. There's a track team practicing, and there's this young man, and I was at the top, and he was coming up. I was watching him. I said, "What is he doing?" He was broad jumping. In other words, you have 2 feet together, and you leap both with both feet together, and then land, like a standing broad jump, not a running long jump, but a standing broad jump. And I said, "What the heck is he doing? He's jumping triples." I mean, I jumped singles before, but he was like, I thought he was jumping triples, and I sort of yelled out to him. I said, "Hey," I said, "How many stairs you doing?" And he says, "Well, right now I'm doing four, but I can do here's five for you." I said, "Come on." And he jumped. I said, "Wait a minute. You just broad jumped five stairs at a time." And then he did more and more. Five, five, five. I said, "What are you kidding me?" I said, "You're a champ." And he was a very nice young man. I said, "How many times have you done this today? I mean, just in your workout here." And he said, I think this was like his 12th time." I said, "You've gone up 12 times and you can still broad jump five stairs at a time going up? That is completely insane." He says, "Yeah." So later on, I saw him. He was down at the bottom, and I said, "Hey, I saw you going down sideways, right? I like that you're doing that." I said, "Have you ever tried going up sideways?" He goes, "No, I never thought of it." And then I demonstrated it to him. You go up sideways. He goes, "Wow, cool, I'll try it." And so he did. But of course, he was doing doubles, going up sideways, doing 2 stairs at a time. And then later on, I saw him. I said, "How'd it go?" And he said, "Ah, it's great. I really like it. It's a really good workout." He said, "Thanks." I said, so I actually coached somebody, amazing young kid that is just these kids. I mean, what they can do is just pretty astonishing, huh? When you're a kid and you're that fit, you're just like a cat. You can leap like that. Come on. And then I tried jumping doubles, and I could do doubles. I might even be able to do triples. I don't know. But five? That's very inspiring. Very inspiring. I said, "Oh my gosh, God's trying to tell me something. Don't, stop jumping singles. Jump. Why want you jumping triples?" But the idea of leaping five, at one time is a very spiritual thing, leaping into the fifth dimension, so to speak, which is the realization of no dimension. There's no dimensions at all. The fifth dimension is a way of just saying that you liberate yourself from the whole belief in layers and levels. And he did it all in one leap. And I was standing there, I was thinking, how many steps can Jesus leap at one time? And the answer is, he's already here. He's already here. All stairs have already been leaped. All stairs have already been leaped. He's already here. So I don't know if he left them all in one leap or but are no leaps. No leaps. He's already here. Now, kids these days are still okay. You're okay as you grow up, but that the world gets a hold of you. Gradually, it strangles you into despair. You have that youthful vitality. You say, "Oh, look at all the stuff I can do. This is so much fun." So they have fun for a while, and then it's not so fun anymore. And that's the trouble, right? And you start falling into karmic habits and habits of attention and troubles like that. The kids are always going to be fun, having fun. That's not the issue. It's the rest of your life that's the issue. I didn't have much fun, actually, because nobody understood what I was talking about. And then karmic habits came in and grabbed me. And I said, "Wow, what? Why not?" Because it was either nobody really paid it, was interested, or paid attention, understood what I was talking about, or they didn't like it. So I said, it's kind of like discouraging, because this the purpose of this world is despair. So the purpose is to discourage us away from truth. Say, no, truth is it's despair. It's discouraging. Stay away from it. It's bad. And we hope that will change what we are. So you come in this world speaking truth. People say, ah, here's my opportunity to help everyone out by discouraging them. And this is what happens. But and time flies away so fast, doesn't it? Too fast. Got on the scale this morning, had a great surprise, wonderful surprise. Oh gosh. August 29th, which is when the idea of last year, the idea of I decided I was going to try and get myself back in shape, at least diet-wise, I started out diet. Well, I sort of had gone on off the wagon diet-wise, and I was like 5 pounds overweight, my target weight. I said, but by September 1st, this is when I really got it rolling. I go month by month. So really, I take this September 1st is the date that I have to weigh in, and I'm 5 pounds overweight, and I have like 3 days to four, 3 days to make it, pretty much. So 4 days if you count September 1st. So I weighed myself this morning. I was basically in the ballpark on the target weight, and then later in the afternoon I was even lower. I was below my target weight, so I dropped 5 pounds in 3.5 days. 5 pounds in 3.5 days, and the Holy Spirit helped me, because all these people kept telling me, just drink water. You need to drink water. You need to drink more water. I said, let me try that. Let me just drink water. So I've been drinking a lot of water, and not eating very much food at all, actually. I eat some. I like having a hard-boiled egg and some peanut butter, and then Greek yogurt for breakfast with walnuts and blueberries. So I'm not starving, but I'm drinking a lot of water, and poof, my weight went back down again. That is tremendous. So the physical can get to us. So if you just ignore it, there are times to ignore it. That's okay. I ignored it at certain times, and there are other times not to ignore it. And the Holy Spirit knows what is best for you. But sometimes you make a big push mentally and you forget all about the body. I've done that many times. It just doesn't matter. Whatever condition the body, it doesn't matter. I'm going to make it in my mind. And then when you get to a certain point, you realize I really got it mentally, but I feel it's just some sort of something. I'm not quite stable enough in some way. And then the Holy Spirit comes in and says, okay, let's get in shape here. So I did two sets of stairs today, and then I said, that's it. And then I rested for a little while, and then I went back and did three more. It's like, wow, what are you doing? I said, ah, come on, I gotta push it. But boy, for the young kids, it's easy for them. Boy, they just have fun. They're just like gazelles. It's ridiculous. I said, how do they do that? I don't know. I don't know if anybody knows how kids could do what they could do. They can skate like crazy too. It's just ridiculous. Again, but today I was just skating, just turning, just weaving, kind of weaving like this, and just and making turns and like, whoa, trying to get it, but get a feel down for it, making turns. And I found out that's how you slow yourself down going down a hill, is you have to make tight turns, carved tight turns, and that does slow you down. I don't know how else to brake going down a hill, right? This is the problem with skateboarding. So the real quick, sharp turns. So instead of going downhill, you're going parallel, going perpendicular to the downhill. So and you can even turn sharply and go uphill a little bit, then loop back down and go downhill, and then make another sharp turn uphill. And you can do like that. That's how you have to do it if road is too steep, and or you can. Anyway, that's the basics. You have to be able to turn. The problem is the tr if the, if what you're skating on is too narrow, then you have you know that's difficult, right? It's difficult. You have to make really tight turns, real fast tight turns. And what I did was I tightened my wheels up really, really tight, so I wouldn't go too fast, and that works. Then going back uphill, I loosened all my wheels so I could push uphill. So I was going faster uphill than I did downhill because the wheels were all nice and loose and flowing. And you might say, well, what does this have to do with enlightenment? Everything has everything to do with enlightenment. There's nothing that doesn't have to do with it, actually. In the Holy Spirit's vision, there's nothing that doesn't have everything to do with it. It's like, not right now. I'm very hungry, But I'm gonna stick with the water, go to bed hungry. That's how you have to do it, right? And maybe I'll hit a pretty good number on the scale tomorrow, and just take it one day at a time. But I'm back on the wagon right now in terms of everything. And again, have to. So September is start in September. It's a very important month, September now. Very important. You realize we basically have 2 months in the United States till the election. 2 months. That's gonna fly by. And then we're gonna find out who the next president is going to be, unless martial law is declared. And this is going to be a mind blower either way, okay? An absolute mind blower either way. Seriously. And B, I'm basically unaligned. I'm not politically aligned. I'm aligned with truth, the Dharma kings. You can see pluses and minuses in both of them, but either way is going to be a mind blower. It really is. For everybody. Either way, you're going down the rabbit hole, right? Seriously, this is just crazy what's going on. Not that we haven't gone down the rabbit hole the last 8 years, we most certainly have, in a most drastic way. And now we're at this crossroads here, and so 2 months is all we have here in the United States, and the rest of the world, of course, has to get a will get an eyeful of the United States. What this is very important for the rest of the world too, actually. Very, 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 very important for the rest of the world. And either way, it's just going to be a freak out, basically, actually. This is true. Whether you like the candidates or not, it will be a freak out, because the polarity is so extreme, is so extreme. The differences are so, they're so, out there in terms of how it's going to go. It's going to go either one way or the other way, and either way it goes, it's going to go that way direction. Very extreme, very extreme. The world will never be the same, essentially. There's no question about it. The world is about to go in some extreme direction. And everybody knows that. And so Holy Spirit knows it, of course, so the Dharma kings. Psychologically, I'm getting younger. Physically, I'm getting older, but I'm trying to, prevent that from getting out of hand. But psychologically, I'm getting younger. It's good to hear this. It's good to hear this. You may think, well, I got to say something non-dual. Well, this is all perfectly non-dual. Okay, the Holy Spirit's even beyond what we call non-dual. Everything just is, and it's aware of every last detail in a 360-degree non-time-based way. And so, an insect is just as significant to a piece of dust, to this, to that, to the Holy Spirit. Everything is its play. So let the Holy Spirit play in your life. This is the best advice there is. And the Holy Spirit brings you to certain Dharma kings, gurus, whatever, sages, saints, and teachers. It brings you to them or not, depending on the Holy Spirit's perfect vision of what is best for you, what is most effective in its orchestration of your liberation from pretense, really. So this is spiritual cross training. It's sort of like super non-dual, you might say. It's like super non-dual. It is permeated by the non-dual realizations, but it doesn't stop there. We need to allow it into our lives in a 360-degree way instead of just some narrow dogmatism of this is non-dual dogmatic teaching or something. Didn't take a video of skateboarding because it was too, I mean, I'm not too dangerous. I was just testing this out. I didn't know how well I could do. And so I did well, so I don't know if I can take a video or not. Well, of course I will try. I imagine I will be able to. I don't know about the balance, having to do it, but I took video of running up and down stairs, which was takes quite a bit of balance. I actually stumbled once, first time I've done that, because I was trying to figure out where's the camera, how am I doing? I wasn't looking at my feet, wasn't paying attention, so I stumbled on the stairs a little bit, but I didn't fall. It's not easy to do that, and everybody's looking at me like, what is he doing? Just out in public and taking like doing what I was doing. Yeah, everyone's like, wow. Oh, what's this? But I just didn't pay them any attention. I just went about my business, and everybody relaxed and said, "Okay, he's going about his business. He knows what he's doing, and that's no trouble." So everybody just got used to it real quickly, and I was just part of the crowd, and that's it. They could tell I was just very earnestly, going about my business. They could see, okay, he's taking video of his feet, footwork, and this and that. And okay, they get it. So just go about your business. Don't try to impress anybody at all. Just whatever you're doing, do it to the best of your ability. And go about your business, and others will respect that. So you see, every day there's just like something different. The Holy Spirit just throws something different my way. One day I'm falling down dead. Next day I'm dancing along the shoulder of the beach in the ocean there, taping it, running stairs. Next day I'm skateboarding, running stairs. I don't know what tomorrow is, really. I do keep up some upper body. I do the PVC shaker thing for the upper body, and what it has done is it's gotten my arms, like my forearms, really strong, because holding that and shaking it, really, you have to have powerful forearms, wrists, and my arms, like, really makes them very strong. The muscles feel really very like iron or something. It's very strong. Interesting. So okay. Because I was watching this old man try to screw this gas cap on his car, and I saw, I said, oh, you really have to be able to still use your arms twisting stuff in order to function in society, don't you? If you can, if you lose your strength in your arms, this is a big problem. So keeping your forearms and your wrists and hands strong is really important. And that shaker, like 1¼ inch, I think I'm using mostly, it really gives you tremendously strong grip and strong forearms. It's a great exercise. You can do it at any age. It's gentle enough. You can make it a little stronger, but it's the reps that you do, the reps you do, it really is, gets you wonderfully. Something that anyone of any age can do. It's a tremendous exercise. You can if you're older and you're weaker, just use like a 3/4 inch or 1/2 inch if you need, and do that and start building the strength up in your arms. People will want to find some sideline, some refuge, really. They will look for it, what's coming up. And so you want to be some helpful in some way, because they're going to get into something. So we're all going to get into something up to just divert our attention away from the madness, right? Remember when you were like 10 years old, you weren't really interested in the news? Maybe for me, it was like, did the Giants win today? I'd look at the box score, the Giants won. Oh, great. But the rest of the stuff, it's like, nah, I'd rather go, go play this or go play that and do this and do that and focus on other stuff. Not really, focused on all the, the global, heavy global scene. This is taking place and all that stuff. And then you see the adults are into that. And then you think, well, no, if I want to grow up, maybe I need to start paying attention to that. Which is a big mistake, actually. So now I'm going back like a 10-year-old and not focusing on the news at all. Instead of, like a skateboarding, like a 10-year-old. So we need to reverse our lives, our psychology back to when it was younger and we didn't have these bad habits of paying attention. Well, who died today and how did they die? And, and who's likely to die? And who's angry at who? Who's angry at who? And what celebrity is, pandering for attention? Why do we need to know anything about celebrities? When I was young, I didn't pay any attention to celebrities except for Willie Mays. Great baseball player, greatest ever in my opinion. I thought he was really cool. But I really, didn't care for celebrities very much at all. When you, I still don't. All this stuff. Who cares? I don't care at all, really. They're just desperate for attention, pandering for attention. Why should I give my attention? I'll give my attention to Jesus Christ. Thank you very much. So every time you spend any time on a celebrity or politician, you're taking away time from the Holy Spirit. You know that? Or in the Dharma Kings. You're taking time away from them. And they could use your time so much better than the celebrities use them. It's a disgrace, the celebrities, really. It's sad. It's very sad. They're very sad people. Don't give them attention. You know what they say? Don't feed the raccoons or don't feed the animals. It'll encourage them. Don't encourage those like that, the celebrities and stuff to keep on trying to be celebrities in that way. They don't have what it takes to be real celebrities. They don't. None of them do. None of them do. Don't encourage them. It's a sad life they live. I came across the most awesome patio I've ever seen today. We're at a place, and it was just amazing. All the stones were like the same and flat, perfectly flat, and everything. And it was just extraordinary. Was huge slabs in the patio, the stones, each one weighing 900 pounds, perfectly level. It was just like, wow. You've seen a lot of patios in your time, right? I mean, but to see one like this was just the best, hands down. Nothing could touch it. It was just really amazing. Wow. And they explained to me, how it was done. I said, wow, okay. Very interesting. They use basalt columns, huge basalt columns, and slice them with a saw. Just slice each one the exact same. So they're all completely level, the exact same depth and level. But the outer circumference being a basalt column, it's all beautifully rounded and scalloped with a nice shape to it, kind of, off round. But and they're all the same. They're all beautifully the same because it's a basalt column. So you slice like salami, you're just slicing pieces of salami, and then they lay out so flat, perfectly flat. You can And then you could slice them vertically and have these perfectly flat, beautiful stones as well. It's like, wow, that's really cool. That we can flatten out everything, can't we, in this world? Do you see that with the Holy Spirit showing? Look, you see how flat, perfectly flat everything can be and solid. What a solid foundation these 900-pound stones were. Beautifully flat, but natural stone. It wasn't like concrete. It looks so beautiful. People want the non-dual truth. We've said it over and over and over again. Why isn't it sink in? Why is it let well, the Holy Spirit knows. The Holy Spirit knows why, so it will direct us in some way. Is somehow Holy Spirit saying you need to have some sort of confidence, moving and flowing and balancing, and I don't know. It's skateboarding is going to help out in some way. Psychologically, go beyond psychology, actually. Psychology is all about despair and how we try and avoid it and manage it. Human psychology, that's all it is, actually. You try to integrate it, integral psychology and all that stuff. It's just all based on despair, actually. Jesus says fear, ultimately, but despair is the tool we're trying to use to change what we are. So go beyond psychology. Go beyond psychology. It's like when you're riding your skateboard, is a complete. It's different than walking around. It's very different. The speed, the turnings. You're suddenly turning like that. I mean, it's completely different than your normal functioning, psychological. So it's a different psychology. You might even say it's beyond psychology. Reality completely transcends psychology, actually. There's no psychology to now at all. To right now, there's no psychology to right now. What psychology does right now need? What psychology does nothing have? Does nothing really have a psychology to it? Okay, it's getting pretty late here. And degreeness. There's technicians, non-dual technicians that can explain it to you this. But for me, the Dharma kings are so different, aren't they? If there's a 360 degreeness about them, look at Ram Maharshi. People would ask him questions, pepper with him questions, he just remained silent. And pretty soon they remained silent too. And he'd say, look, all that stuff, it's nonsense. It's this and this and this, leave that alone. And just poof, cuts right through it. Simple, quick, direct statements that he makes is so wonderful. Don't need to be a technician. What is there to understand? What do we need to understand about nothing? How long does it take to understand nothing? What is there to understand, and how long does it take to understand it? These are good questions to ask, to pose to ourselves, to state to ourselves. Actually, we're not really asking anything, we're just stating it. It's a statement in the form of a question. Questions are really like this. They're really statements. What is there to understand about nothing, and how long does it take? How long does it take to understand nothing? And what is it that we need to understand? How long would it take? Nothing. So making these statements is, quite shocking, quite wowish. Because you're pointing to something very profound. It's just, what is there to understand about nothing, and how long does it take? What is there to understand about nothing, and how long does it take? Now we're kind of like foggy, like, yeah, but, and we wonder why isn't it obvious to us, right? Well, this is the question. We think it's, we say, well, it should be obvious, but it isn't quite. So you don't get into this, well, it should be, and get upset with yourself. Like a young adolescent, sometimes they're so hard on themselves, they strike out, they get furious with themselves. They're just brutally tough on themselves. I used to be very tough on myself. I mean, I demanded like perfection, and if I didn't get it, I was just like, okay, I'm gonna practice, 10 hours a day until I get it. This is totally unacceptable to me, if I don't do it right. Really, very severe. But how severe do we need to be in order to get rid of nothing? What kind of severity do we need? And do we need to cure nothing? Do we need to cure nothing? Needs to be, does nothing need to be cured? What does it need to be cured of? What does nothing need to be cured of? Beautiful day today. Another gorgeous day. We're getting, yeah, it's really, I don't know what to say. It's a lovely day. The crickets are softly purring away. California's outdoing itself right now. And it's not hot. It's not hot. It's just pleasantly warm with a soft, cool breeze, and just, I don't know, it's like a different season. I don't even know what kind of season you'd call it. It's sort of a combination of summer, autumn, and spring. It's like a combination of all three. That's pretty nice, huh? Combine those three in the best way, and you get today. Didn't do the core work. That's what really fries you. I've been doing that the last several days. I didn't do any today because just lying on something that half ball that's unstable, and then rolling back and forth side to side in various movements. It's just your body is absolutely not accustomed to doing that. So it's doing the unaccustomed that really gets you. But this is the secret to real great cross training, is keep doing stuff that your body's not used to. So I told that young man that can do those stairs like incredibly well. I said, try running sideways. He goes, oh, I never thought of that. I like that. Let me try that. And right away he tries it. And later on he tells me, yeah, that's a good one. I like that. So something new, he hasn't done before. He's feeling it. I said, you feel it? I said, yeah. I said, because it's using, it's a different motion, than you're normally used to. It gets your core, it's really good core doing that. I mean, I discovered a new way of going downstairs again today, where you kind of leap up, hop up and down, and so it gives you a whole different feel than just trotting down the stairs. Very different, and it's great. But this is what young people do, right? I mean, they invent stuff. They try different stuff. They say, oh, let me try this. Let me try this. Well, who said we're supposed to stop doing that? So here I am, a 60-year-old teaching a 17-year-old, so a new workout practice, right? But who said we're supposed to stop being, me? Inventing stuff in this way and coming up with new things and trying this and doing different. Who said we're supposed to be locked into this robotic, age thing? I don't know. It's convention, isn't it? Isn't it convention? Sure it is. Now you get this fitness thing for elders that the people, jogging and doing swimming, doing jogging. But when do you ever see an elder like I'm walking across a parking lot, and suddenly I just start skipping. I want to skip the rest of the way, or I'll just like run sideways, into the store. Do you ever see that them do that? No, you don't. You never see that. You never see it. And there's something very interesting about our mind, egoic psychology, in terms of if nobody's doing it, it must not be possible to do. We draw this conclusion. So we say, well, why is then the, it's circular. Then we say, well, why is nobody doing it? Because you can't do it. That's why they're not doing it. And when they're not, nobody's doing it. That's because it's, that they can't do it. And so I'm not doing it because it can't be done. And then we get trapped by this. What do you mean somebody cannot skip across a parking lot? This all kind of got really revved up at the Wow, at Wowchella 2:16. Looking forward to Wowchella 2:17 at this point, right? Oh, our Wowchella 2:16 too. let's make it a habit. The Dharma Kings really put forth some very profound new habits for me, and directions and awakenings. There's going to be a lot of trouble in the world, plain and simple. Severe psychological problems for the world. People are going to get very foggy and hazy about their clarity. I was talking about to a dyslexic man today, and he said, I used to be very bad, but I've sort of overcome it by just having to be tremendously focused and committed. I say, I use the word commitment. I said, you got to be committed to what you're doing. He said, yeah, really committed. And if I really focus, I don't start flipping the words around, flipping stuff around. But he said, I really have to, had to work at it really seriously. And I said, and when I get really stressed, it flips, goes back into dyslexia. And I said, you know what? I think we're all kind of dyslexic under pressure. If the pressure gets bad enough, you start flipping things. This is true, right? Do we not? I said, yeah, I realized to myself, this can happen. So when we're put under too much pressure, we all go nuts, you might say. Dyslexia is the least of our troubles, is that we start floundering, you might say. So there's going to be this psychological floundering taking place. And it's just people won't be able to see, how to move, where should I go, the direction, I don't see the direction where happiness is. They'll lose the sense of I, they'll feel that they don't know what direction to go in to be happy anymore. This is what's going to happen. So, bit by bit by bit, I'm doing all this innovative stuff that kind of helps open up something for us that maybe, we can do stuff that is some direction. Some direction is better than none. The worst thing is to flounder in no direction. And of course, we want to find a good direction, but if it's so foggy and dusty, you can't tell. Mentally foggy, you don't know what direction to go and do. This is the trap of of any age, but old age oftentimes their minds become so foggy that they just can't tell what direction to go in, and so they end up just watching television and hoping that it's good for them. And of course, it's not. It's terrible for them. I'm meeting some good. Everyone I meet is wonderful. Today, a couple of guys that I know them, and they were giving me some very, very cool insights, and it was great. It was just, they're still like they can still see clearly enough to say, okay, this makes me happy, and this doesn't. In the future, this kind of future will help me be happy, and this won't. And they're still. Common sense, simple common sense, they're still able to apply it. And who do you want running the world? Engineers or gurus? Dharma kings. I want Dharma kings running the world. Plain and simple. There's no two ways about that at all. It's so completely obvious. But then we go, wow, no, can I say that? Yeah. But in Silicon Valley, it's just all engineers. They plan on running the future. Totally. They have it all mapped out. So, oh, yeah, this is what we're going to do. This is what we're going to do. They think they know what our future is, engineers. Well, they couldn't be more mistaken. As I always say, what do you say if what do we say if something isn't broke, don't fix it? What does an engineer say? If something isn't broken, give it more features. Give it more options, more features. See? Yeah. But common sense, hey, if it's not broken, don't try to fix it. Not to an engineer. It needs more features. Come on. Let's engineer more stuff into it. So there's an entire current in the world to have an engineered future from scientists and engineers. This is what many want in this world. There's another that other current where many want religious, spiritual gurus, Dharma king, saviors to lead the world, to shape our future and yeah, let the Holy Spirit shape our future. That so the division is extreme. I mean, it's just a totally extreme division. So this my friend was having a conversation with someone who's an engineer, and the engineer said, "We're not gonna have any more. In the future, you won't own a car. There'll be just pods, and you'll have to you'll let, send a text. You want to go to the market or something. The pod will show up at your house and take you there, and then could make it back and drop you off. And you won't own cars or anything like that." And my friend said, "Oh, wait." And so my friend was saying, "Wait a minute. Let me." And he's pointing out all these troubles with this. And he said, finally, the engineer said, "Wow, you're right. I kind of need to rethink this a little bit here. It's like you, yeah. I'm not. I thought I had it all figured out." The engineers thought, "No, everything's fine." The objections, no. And my friend brought up all these really bright, obvious objections. And the engineer said, "Wow, yeah." But their plan is no car ownership, no ownership of a lot of stuff. If the government, and my friend said, "Who's got to own it? The government? What if the government doesn't like you? What if you say something they don't like? No more car rides to the market, No more going anywhere. Is what? Then essentially you're imprisoned, are you not? Very much so. If you can't get in your car and go where you want to go, aren't you in prison? Isn't that the definition of a prison?" Yeah, it is. Prison without walls, without barbed wire, but a bureaucratic, engineered, technological prison. And this is what we're headed towards, actually. The engineers feel that they know what's best for us. But you know what? I'll take the Holy Spirit's future for me. And the Holy Spirit's saying, "Go skate. Go on your, get on your skateboard." Very low-tech thing, isn't it? You know what? I'll tell you what. If all electronics fail, I can skate to the market, you could say you could ride a bike too, but they'll probably make bikes electronic in some way too, so but you could walk to the market, you can run. I can skateboard to the market. It's still tech, but it's low tech. So I got transportation, it's free. No gasoline required. No electronics required. No electronics required in skateboards. Just four wheels, a piece of plywood, and some steel to trucks on it. But but it's very low tech. Very low tech. You can tighten the wheels. You can loosen the wheel. One wrench. Get a wrench. It's easy. Where is that wrench that I used today? Oh, it's in my. In my pocket, I think, still. I tightened them up, loosened them up. Tightened, I did very smart stuff. I loosened the trucks up so they're very, very loose. So that means I could just turn really, really easily. And that's what you want when you want the wheels tight and the trucks loose when you're going downhill so you can slow yourself down. And when you're going uphill, you want the trucks tighter and the wheels looser because you don't really want to slow yourself down going uphill too much by turning too much. So you don't want to just easily do a severe turn. That just slows you down like that. So I've got it. I can adjust my board now depending on conditions, which is, it's just part of being smart. And that's what this guy's in the skate shop told me. He says, you'll figure it out. Just you can change, the parameters of your skateboard so you get it the way you want it. So just work with it and you'll figure it out. They're very much that way. They say, just you'll figure it out. Just work with it, you'll figure it out. Kind of spiritual, isn't it? Just every day, look at your mind, pay attention, and be aware of synchronicities and insights and breakthroughs that arise in your mind, and you gradually start figuring it out. Be self-reliant on that as much, you know, and get the help where you find it if you come across it, by all means. But be independent, self-reliant, and skate your way through the spiritual path, and you know, find your style, find what works for you, and get really good at it. That's a nice metaphor. Skateboarders, everybody will say, "You can't do that, you can't do that, you can't do that," and when they do it, it's like, "What? How'd you do that?" And, Rodney Mullen is just too much, man. Somebody said it when he was young, and he noticed that he had just super dexterity with his feet. Yeah, I guess so. His feet are so dexterous, it's scary, actually. How the timing of everything, how you just land it, and how they land everything, I don't know. It's talented. These are gymnasts, aerialists, gymnasts, you name it. That's okay, no worries. Let them be what they are. We'll be what we are. Maybe skating will help clear people's minds. You know, you really have to be very Holy Spirit guided to be able to do it and not hurt yourself, and protected by the Dharma kings. And you have to be very conservative to ease yourself into it, and be realistic, and not overconfident. You cannot be overconfident. This is a disease of the world. So it's a great discipline to apply your spiritual talents to, because these apply to the spiritual path too. You cannot be overconfident. You cannot be reckless. You really need to full stop on the wow. You go to going too fast, slow down, all right, and let it settle in, and keep and smooth it out. Be smooth in your path. Skateboarding, you want to smooth it out, and yeah, a lot of parallels. Roller skating, rollerblading, you could also do that. What's happened to rollerblading? It's disappeared. I never see anyone rollerblading anymore. Never. Just gone. I used to rollerblade. I wasn't good at it at all. I just tried it a little bit. You know, it's sort of I said, "Well, I just want to see what this is about." I never did it enough to get good at it. But that's a blast. That is really cool. It really is. You can leap a lot easier, slow down easier. You do your, it's great. What, you know, the rollerblading was such a big thing. Vanished. So it's a fad. You know, fads come and go. What's the next fad? I don't know. Maybe we'll go back to people will go back to rollerblading. Well, the fad now is mountain biking. Expensive fad. It's too extreme for me, the mountain biking. It just I like the more of the gliding, smooth. I don't know, something. I don't know. I've not ever really done anything technical, mountain biking or anything. I just trying to go up hills, and it was just too difficult. It's terrible. It's horrible. It's a grind. It's just a torture grind. Good thing about skating, like the bowls and skating the stuff, it's always there. Like the ocean, though, the waves are like rarely there. And you go, "Let's check the waves out." "Ah, they're no good. Let's check the waves out." But skating, the sidewalk's always there. It's always good. Or whatever you're skating, it's always there. You can do it every day. It's interesting. Spiritual path, you can do every day. It's there every day for you. You don't have to wait for some nice weather to focus on what the Holy Spirit wants you to focus on. Just ask the Holy Spirit, "What do you want me to focus on?" You play the music. I'll pay attention. And it will play your attention. The piano that it's playing is your attention, actually. The Holy Spirit plays your attention. That's the instrument that you are. It's your mind, is attention. And it plays your attention. That's all it does. All right, very great. Okay, it's an hour. It's an hour. It's enough for now. That's enough. Getting late. Keep it smooth. And there's surprises. Don't be surprised if I surprise you in various ways. That video at the beach, right? That was a surprise. The dropping dead video too. How to drop dead safely. I mean, that's hilarious. I mean, if you drop dead, who cares? Who cares about how safe it is? It's too late for to worry about safety at that point, right? But if you focus on dropping dead safely, isn't that kind of a non-dual? Just just blows your mind. I mean, I'm dropping dead safely. Just consider that. How that flips a script somewhere in our mind. Like, hey, I can learn how to drop dead safely. And then actually doing it. This is a whole different level of spiritual practice. It sort of shocks, deep shock to our psyche in some ways. Just I keep dying safely. Okay, that was a safe dying. 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 Huh? And then I get up. It just absolutely turns this different way than your normal. But of course, the normal's not so great for us, is it? It's not really getting the job done, is it? It certainly isn't. Normal for this world? It's not good, is it? It's not good at all. It's I look at the world's just despair, despair. Everyone's in despair. Young people are hopeful, hope and fear go together, don't they? And so hope leads to despair. If you have the Holy Spirit, you don't have hope. You have a sure thing. You have a sure thing. That's not hope. So the profundity is just coming up all day for me constantly now. It's just all right. So just ask the Holy Spirit to play your attention for you. And it will play your attention, and you will start noticing, hey, I never noticed that before. I never noticed that before. Oh, you'll see some dynamic of the mind, like, wow, I completely escaped my attention my whole life. How is that possible, you'd say? How's that possible? It's so obvious to me now. How could anything so obvious have escaped my attention for my entire life? This is what happens with the Holy Spirit. You just start noticing the play of attention that's going on. You say, wait a minute, why is my attention keep going back to this? That's crazy. That's stupid. I don't need to do that. It shouldn't be doing that. Oh, it's a habit I've been into. Oh, how did I get that habit? That's horrible. A moment's fixation, a moment's inattention, lazy inattention. The mind moments turns into a momentary habit. Do something, turns into habit, turns into a fixation, turns into a lifetime. I'm noticing people now, I see they're all fixated, and most of them are just fixated for a lifetime. They just don't get anywhere at all in terms of their getting free of their fixation. I said, look at some people today. I said, wait a minute, you've been fixated since you were girls, in junior high school. There's two ladies, they women. They were smoking their cigarettes, and I said, and then laughing and gossiping, and I realized, you take you back to junior high school, minus the cigarettes, or maybe they were sneaking them back then too, but exactly the same. I mean, they're just fixated, but not in a good way, in a fixated through life way. So many get fixated so early. I didn't get fixated so early. And never really quite did get fixated. And when I play like guitar, I was always doing something different. Always experimenting, doing something different. I never like wanted to play a song like I gotta play it a certain way. I said, nah, I just want to see, I want to try something else. Let me try this, let me try this, let me try this. So I never really fixated on any style or any way of playing musical instruments. I said, well, today I feel like playing like this. And then the next day, well, I feel different. I'm gonna play like this. And it's just always different. So this helps in not fixating on hope and fear. And just hoping, hoping like, well, maybe this way, this will bring me happiness. And that's, they get so cloudy minded, they just fixate on some sort of something and then just, hope that this will, hope that the pharmaceutical companies don't know about their fixation and aren't exploiting them. Oh, well, that's, don't put your hope in that. Don't put your trust and faith in that happening. Fear, 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 fear. Despair, despair, despair. Sickness, sickness, sickness. Drugs, 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 drugs. Right? Yeah. Okay. Very great. We never know what the next day will bring. I sure don't. Next day for me is like unknown. Really, it is. I really, because today was like, wow. Just, but I get tomorrow, the Holy Spirit will wow me. I guess I do know that the Holy Spirit in some way is really just going to wow me, wow me, wow me, wow me, wow me, like that. I was driving, I made a wrong turn. I said, what am I doing? And then I turn around and go back to where I was going. And then suddenly I get a call on the phone and says, hey, did you just drive by this house? I said, oh yeah, as a matter of fact, I did. I made a wrong turn. They said, well, we need you to come back. We need the key. We can't get in. We need the key. I said, oh yeah, well, I'm real close. I'll just turn around and go back. So I turn around and go back and help them out. And it's like, you see, there is a God, is there not? Synchronicity is like, I just happened for some reason to turn down that street, and then they needed me right then. They said, oh my gosh, isn't this great? They said, he has the key. We'll call him right away. And that's how it happened. So I said, now I know why I turned down that street to help you out. Amazing. Is that mind blowing? It happens all the time to me now. It's just happening consistently. Everything is like this, orchestrated by the Holy Spirit. And I just more and more just sit back and let the Holy Spirit drive and just enjoy it. Okay, and you can do the same. You absolutely can do the same. Just let the Holy Spirit be the musician that plays the piano of your attention. Okay, and you will not regret this at all. Absolutely not. It takes you away from despair, away from regret, away from misery and suffering. It takes you away from all of that to what you really want. Very great. That's it for this.